Hello everyone, Meg here, and in this video we are taking a look at some of the essential items you're going to need for your affordable home studio setup. And as Christmas is around the corner, we thought we'd take a look at this so you get some ideas for your stocking fillers and essential things that you might not have in your home recording studio. So first things first, I think the number one essential item you're going to need to get going is of course an interface. If you aren't familiar with what an interface is, then if you've ever been to a big recording studio, you will see those huge desks where you plug everything into. When you're at home, you're obviously not going to have one of those. So an interface is a USB version with anywhere from 1 to 2 to 6 to 8 channels, depending on what you need, which you can use as your at-home box to record all of your instruments into. So in this video, we're going to take a look at an affordable option, which would be the Trumix TM12. This is a 2-channel USB interface, which has phantom power for your condenser microphones. We'll touch on that a little bit when we look at the condenser mic options. But that's something that you're going to need if you're recording vocals or guitar, acoustic guitar, for example, with a microphone at home. You also have a headphone output, so you can monitor it through headphones, as well as an output for your studio monitors. When you're producing at home, it's pretty good to get both running at the same time so you can hear it through headphones as well as out in the room with some speakers. So the Trumix TM12 is very easy to use, nice and affordable, and is the exact thing you need to get your setup going. Because it is USB as well, you can use it with whatever device you are using. So if you have an Apple Mac or a PC or a laptop, this is going to work with any of them. So as I mentioned, you've got your interface, but you're going to need something to hear your audio back through. First thing to look at would be some studio monitors that you can use at home. If you're recording at home, generally it tends to be in a bedroom or a small studio environment. So you're only really going to be looking at, I'd imagine, some 5-inch or possibly some 7-inch speakers. In this video, we're having a look at the Trumix AR5s, which are some 5-inch studio monitors. These are nice and affordable, so they're budget friendly if this is your first time setting up your own home studio. These things can get a little expensive, so you want to keep it as budget friendly as possible. These will be a great option. On the back, you've got an XLR in, which you can use to connect up to your interface, like the Trumix one over here. Typically, you'd want to be using a male XLR to jack to connect these up. If you have two running, then you can get the stereo sound going, which is optimum for recording. These studio monitors have a nice blend of bass and mids, which is optimum for a variety of different ways you might be using them. If you're recording acoustic guitar, for example, then you're going to want quite a bassy sound from your speakers. If you're mixing more production based or electronic music, then you're going to want a blend of mids and trebles as well. So these are a great option if you want to get going with your affordable studio monitor setup at home. As I said before as well, it would be handy to have a pair of headphones so you can listen back in two different ways. These Trumix headphones, the SDH50s, are another affordable option. Close back is optimum for this, so you've got an isolation from the room around you and you can hear the music coming in properly. Blending between the two is just a better way to get a full scope of the production you're doing. These headphones have a 40mm driver and they also come with soft vegan leather, so cruelty-free. You also have an adapter on the end, so depending on whether you need to use these with a 3.5mm end or a 1/4-inch jack, you have the adapter for both. Generally, when it comes to interfaces, you'll have a 1/4-inch jack on the back, so this is particularly useful. If you did want to use these for any other applications, like with your amp for practicing at home, often they'll be 3.5, so you have both on there. So that's your audio in and your audio out. You've got a device to get your music into and you've got something to listen back to. Now, it depends what sort of setup you're doing, but if you are anything like myself and you're going to be recording vocals, guitars, and you might be miking up your amplifiers, then the next key thing would be to look at a microphone. There's lots of different microphone options out there that you can choose from, but one of the key things with recording is you're going to want to go for a condenser microphone. If you don't know the difference, then dynamic microphones are the microphones you generally use on stage. They're a lot less sensitive and made more for the aggressive and heavy use that you'd have in a stage environment. So if you were to be singing pretty loud in a room, they're not going to pick up all the nuances in your voice. For this reason, you'll want a slightly more sensitive microphone when you're recording. Condenser mics are a lot more sensitive and come in many different polar patterns. So depending on what application you're using them for, you can change the polar pattern to just pick up directly in front of the mic, all the way around the microphone, or just certain parts of the room. For at-home studio recording, cardioid is probably the most popular, which is where it'll be picking up the front of the microphone and cutting out the background noise from the back. As these are a lot more sensitive, then they do require phantom power. As I mentioned earlier, this does come with most interfaces, but this will just give you the power to get these mics going. They are very sensitive, so when you are singing, you can pick up a little too many nuances. For that reason, it can be quite useful to get yourself a pop filter if you are singing. There's lots of different pop filters out there. This is the SE Electronics one, and generally they come in at around £15 to £20, so they're very affordable, but they help to cut out any of the puh and s that comes through when you're singing vocals. This is the sort of thing, if you were recording in a studio environment, that they would take care of for you. So it gives you a lot less hassle when you're in the editing stage if you don't have to cut out all of those nasty sounds. It's also be a good time to mention that if you haven't heard of one, a reflection filter is a great tool for using at home if you are recording vocals in your home studio. Reflection filters are essentially a mini vocal booth you can set up at home. They go around the back of the microphone and they help with any acoustic dampening. As these microphones do tend to pick up a bit more background noise in your room, if you have a particularly noisy environment, then this will be really useful if you're recording vocals. The mics I've got up here are two different levels. So you've got the Marantz one, which would be a more affordable and USB option. This would be handy if you're recording on the go and you don't have your interface with you. You can still use this microphone by plugging directly into your PC or laptop. But generally, microphones are going to be XLR in or out. So something like the Rode NT1 or the NT1A are highly sensitive, multi-patterned condenser microphones, so you can use them for a variety of different uses. You could take this out and record vocals and guitar in cardioid, or you could set it to an omni pattern, which will pick up all the different sounds in a room if you're recording something like a choir or an orchestra. Now might be a good time to mention, if you've got your microphone set up, then you're obviously going to need some additional accessories like a mic stand. When you're recording vocals, it is quite useful to have an upright boom stand that you can adjust to be upright so you can position it away from you. The placement of your microphone is very important with not picking up too much loud noise or boom from your voice or your guitar, so this would be a good time to get yourself a mic stand. Most vocal microphones like the NT1 come already with the shock mount, so you won't need to buy that additional part. This will just attach onto your mic stand nice and easy. If you're looking to dive a little bit more into electronic or producer music and you want something to go on your Christmas list this year, then this might be a good time to dive into MIDI keyboards. Any musician can use these and they are nice and easy to use. They just USB connect into your device. You can use these MIDI keyboards to create virtually any sound you want. Most of the software that you could be recording with will have limited or unlimited libraries, depending on what software you're on, of different sounds and instruments. Using these MIDI keyboards would be a great way to get piano, keyboard, synth, strings, or anything else you could possibly think of onto your track. If you don't have yourself a keyboard already and you want to keep your home studio set up nice and budget friendly, then something simple like the Akai LPK25 would be an affordable and easy to use option to get you started with keys. You could have this set up as just a piano if you want to be practicing keys. And as I said, you could also have this program to anything from drums to synths to strings. This can really open up your production capabilities at home, so a MIDI keyboard is a really useful tool to have. I've also put the Oxygen 25 behind me, as this is a great little MIDI keyboard to get you going if you want to start using sample pads. You can program these to create beats, which is a really fun way of creating music. You can have different soundscapes on there, and this can really open up your production style. So if you want something a bit more advanced than the LPK25, the M-Audio Oxygen 25 is a great option. Just like the other one, it's USB, so connect it straight up to your device and you can get going with all the different sounds you could possibly imagine. That's pretty much all of the essentials you'd need to get a home studio set up at home. One other thing to mention is, once you have got all of this, you will obviously need to get yourself some software. that would be called a DAW in the music production world, and there's loads of different options out there. If you want to start on something free to get you going, if you're on Apple, there's GarageBand and many others you can look for. And there's a whole host of different ones that you can pay for and have a play around with. But that's just a side note. If you want to get recording, you will need some software to get going with. I think that's pretty much everything I could think of that would be essential to starting up your home studio at home. If there's anything else that you think is essential, then do let us know in the comments, but hopefully that has been helpful. If you've enjoyed this video, make sure you give it a like and subscribe to the channel. You can also follow us on our socials. I've been Meg, and I will see you all very soon.